Hi, I'm Peter from URender, and in this video I will show you fundamental and important principles about how to work with lights. It's a global concept based on film and photography, and you can use it in a lot of cases. The good thing is that you don't need special assets. You can even use a simple sphere. So practice this lesson as often as you can, and I guarantee that your work will greatly benefit from it. I like to use 3D scans when doing these lighting exercises. You can find tons of models on 3dscans.com or on myminifactory.com Scan the World. For this lesson, I will use a head scan from 3D Scan Store. We directly dive into one of the most important lighting setups, that is called 3-point lighting. After that, we will have a look about special kinds of light setups that are all based on 3D point lighting. First of all, it is very important that you don't rush forward. I know that we all like to start directly and put in tons of stuff and then try so long until we get a nice result. This approach can work, but at some time you would need to work more focused with a clearer goal. Make the progress step by step. When you put in too much light information into your scene, the adjustment for each one gets harder. Let's say you have a nice asset. Now it is very important that the first thing before you continue is to ask yourself one question. What do I want to do? Do I want a creepy scene, a dark threatening scene, a bright friendly scene, or whatever? And then you decide two things, the camera perspective and the light sources. If you don't start with your camera, the chance that you have to rework your complete lighting setup is very high. Worst case, you have to do it completely new from scratch. I want to create a classic portrait light setup. To do this, I choose a camera with a focal length between 80 and 120. If you choose a lower one, exposed body parts like the nose can be distorted too much and it looks more like a cartoon. If the focal length is too high, the face may become too flat. This does not mean that you have to take 80-120 every time, it's just a very conscious decision you have to make. Also, the position of the camera is very important. If you put your camera lower, you put the viewer in a lower position and the model appears taller, threatening, majestic. If you put your camera on a higher position, your model looks smaller and more submissive. So for a neutral appearance, putting your camera on eye level height is a good way to start. Next question is if you should position your camera directly in front of your face. In my opinion, it is up to you. The classic way would be moving it so long to one side until the opposite ear disappears. Now, as I'm happy with my camera, I disable any kind of light in the scene. That also means deactivating the environment map and ambient light if it is set. Before I start, I want to point something out to you. Think briefly about the material of your object. Is it bright or dark? Very glossy or rough? If the texture has a lot of contrast and information, it can be a little bit harder to set up the lights. Especially in this case, I like to assign a neutral material, a simple crayon with a color value that roughly matches the final material you will use. If you don't know at this time, just use a 50% gray material with medium glossiness. In my case, I will use the final material. Creating a 3-point light means it consists of three light sources: key light, fill light, and backlight. Depending on the industry you're working in, the names for those lights may be different. First, I start with the key light and put it under a null object. This is the light source that will lighten the most areas of your object and also define the main shadows you will see. The classic way would be that it is somewhere near the camera. Now I use the null object and just look what happens to the face when I rotate it. How the shadows move, how the complete expression changes if you place your light more from above or from the bottom. Always keep in mind, everything you do has an effect. Try to hold on when you change something and ask yourself, what has changed now and what does it mean? Does my object look now more the way I intend to do? If yes, it seems it is the right way. If not, change it and never skip it and continue your work by adding other things. For the key light there is also a little hint. In real life, our eyes are used to assign objects that are illuminated in blue to the background and objects that are illuminated with a warm color to the foreground. So I can use this and set the color of our key light to a warm value. Now I can create our second light. This will be the backlight and it is something like the antagonist of the key light and therefore placed in the opposite position. I will set it to a cold color. The goal is to have a defined silhouette of the object. It can be set very bright and thin. In this case, it is also called rim light. Or give it a little bit more area for illumination. When you are happy with it, activate the key light now and check how both are working together. Also, activate and deactivate the backlight and recognize what huge impact it has for the appearance of your object. Maybe you will now have the impression that you want to adjust your both lights together. That's not a problem. Just create another null object. Now you can fine-tune both lights at the same time. The third light is called fill light and it can be used to get rid of two dark shadows that are casted by your key light. Just place it next to your key light and then adjust the color and intensity. This is now a classic three-point light setup. Well done! Now I set the background color and activate the environment map and IBL again. Just start with low values and increase it until you get the result you like. Also, adjust the rotation that it fits your three-point light as best as possible. After some practice, you are able to make this complete setup within a few minutes. Everything I told you so far are not rules that are set in stone. It is just a foundation and once you have mastered it, you can now play with it. Why not set the backlight as your main light source and keep the key and fill light with a very low intensity? It's up to you and what you would like to achieve. So there are some fundamentals and versions of the three-point light setup that are often used in classical arts and photography. There are a couple of them. I will show you the ones I like most. The split lighting is some kind of strong side light. So I will set the key light to approximately 90 degrees to the side of the object. You also can deactivate the fill light at all and decrease the environment map to get maximum contrast. What I like doing when using split lighting is to use a slight rim light, but it is totally up to you. Normally there is no backlight used. A very common variation of split lighting is the Rembrandt lighting. It is also a strong side light, but this time the key light is positioned in a way that a characteristic triangle is shown on the cheek on the dark side. So it doesn't hide so much than the split lighting. In general, this is an important part of the three-point light setup and defines the silhouette of the object. It is also possible to use the backlight as your main light source and turn off the key and fill light or set them up with a very low intensity. This gives an appearance where you hide more things than you show. This is a good way if you want to get a mystical and exciting appearance of your object. The characteristic of the butterfly lighting is a little shadow under the nose that is cast by a key light that is positioned directly in front of the face. It is recommended that the softness of the shadow is not set too hard. Because of this setup, the shadow under the chin is very strong too, so it could be a good idea to brighten that area up with a fill light. These are just some basics that should inspire you to experiment with lights. Of course, everything I showed you today works nicely with other objects too, so it has not to be a face to be useful. Always remember, your camera and light adds a narrative to your scene and can emphasize the story you want to tell. So practice it and use it purposefully. Thanks for watching.